Not at all.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, colleagues from different parts of the world connecting to this webinar. Welcome. We are very happy here in New York to kick off this webinar series organized by the human rights teams within Program Division. We are very happy to see that colleagues are connecting from different improve accountability for child rights in the context of a new SDG framework. Today, the focus is on the national independent human rights institutions. We are interested in discussing the various forms they can take, their role in promoting, defending, and monitoring child rights, and the ways UNICEF can strengthen its engagement with them. To unpack and discuss these important issues with us today, we have a very interesting and diverse panel of experts to share their perspective. We are very pleased to have with us Ted Chivan, Director of Program Division here in UNICEF New York. Thank you, Ted, for joining us. We have from Paris right now, Vanessa Stedletsky, international consultant and the lead author of a study that some of you may still be using for your daily work. I'm referring to the Innocenti Global Study on National Human Rights Institutions. She has agreed to join this panel, and we are very thankful and pleased to have you, Vanessa, with us today. Can you hear us?
Yes, absolutely. Thank you.
Great. We also have from Germany, sitting in Berlin, Dominik Bach from the German Institute for Human Rights. They have recently inaugurated their child rights unit, and this is very interesting for us to know how we can learn from an institution that is operating in a country where, for us, we don't have a country program. And to establish some sort of a comparison, we have our colleague Regina De Dominicis, representative of the UNICEF office in Morocco, who also can bring a different perspective on how UNICEF is engaging with these institutions. Dominique and Regina, glad to have you here. Can you hear us?
Yes. Dominic? Very well.
Regina?
Me too. Thank you.
Okay, great. We have all the panel connected. Thank you again, colleagues, for joining. At the moment, we have already 35 colleagues connected and counting. Before we start, just a couple of ground rules. Please put your microphones on mute, and if you have questions, feel free to type them. We will collect them and distribute to the relevant panelists so that we have really a very productive time. And without further ado, I'm going to hand it over to Ted to kick off this conversation. Ted?
So, colleagues, wherever you are around the world, it's a real pleasure to be in this first part of a Human Rights Unit webinar series on accountability, and welcome from a very cold New York City today. I'm quite excited to be able to speak to this issue because of the importance of accountability as a central principle in human rights law, and really looking at what can we do to ensure that those charged with protecting and fulfilling child rights actually do what they're expected to do. And if they can't do what they're expected to do, that children and their representative have some recourse, whether that's a question of omission or commission, as the case may be. Accountability mechanisms take a variety of shapes and forms, and I'm sure we'll hear from the different speakers today about different ways that this is addressed in different contexts. But I wanted to give a bit more from my experience as well about the different ways that child rights can be strengthened at country level specifically as we move towards the 2030 Sustainable Development Agenda and the centrality really of child rights within that agenda. You know, for me, and I think for us overall, the first line of defense are always the immediate duty bearers. So, you know, parents, communities, line ministries, parliament, but national human rights institutions play a critical role in the protection and realization of human rights and in supporting improved accountability. And they can take many different forms, whether it's ombudsperson, human rights commissions, children's commissioner. They can vary from context to context and vary in terms of what they do, whether it's monitoring or indeed including a complaint mechanism for children and their families. But in all cases, they're there to promote and be responsive to the rights of children. And let me give a few examples from different places that I found particularly interesting. And you know, one of my first experiences personally with this has been in Sri Lanka, where you know, as far back as 1998, there was the establishment of a National Child Protection Authority, you know, independent of government and reporting directly to the presidency to hold all accountable on the realization of child rights. And over time, you know, they decentralized themselves. So in every district, there was a district child protection committee bringing together kind of government officials, civil society constituents, and children themselves to kind of address different issues and hold different parties accountable for the realization of child rights, training of officials on child protection rights and monitoring. So those are one example. Another example I would say is the experience from many countries in Latin America where we've had defensorias or ombudsperson for children within the general human rights institutions. UNICEF typically engages with those and provides both technical support and capacity development, but really works kind of on joint advocacy issues, whether those relate to juvenile justice or corporal punishment, or indeed information management and awareness about child rights. Interesting. I was in Norway about 10 days ago and went to see one of the children's houses. And you think of Norway as being a place where, you know, this agenda has been far advanced, where there's been structures and systems in place. And yet, this is a relatively recent development, this development of children's houses, a one-stop shop, which brings a multidisciplinary team together around victims of violence and abuse. And this is an entity that had been recommended by the ombudsperson to address gaps in a child-sensitive approach to justice for children, and you know, only recently had been established in Norway. And then lastly, to make the point that these kind of institutional arrangements exist in a number of settings. Places like Sudan, which have struggled significantly with the realization of child rights, have also had strong institutions that have followed up on child rights. I think here of the National Council of Child Welfare in Sudan, which in the midst of the Darfur conflict, in the midst of fordfighting in the Nuba Mountains in South Kordofan, nonetheless kept within the context, and again, with great difficulties, fighting for demobilization of child soldiers, and indeed set up a whole system of foster care for abandoned children in Khartoum you know, profound benefits for children who previously were dying because they were being abandoned. So I think the bottom line is that you have in different contexts, you know, this as a key pillar of a child rights approach and accountability to child rights. Mm-hmm. And it becomes particularly important that we engage with national human rights institutions or NHRIs as we go into the SDGs, both because of the universality of that agenda, because of the equity component of that agenda, but essentially also because child rights are such an essential accelerator of the SDGs, and you know, in and of themselves are you know, the pillar stone of what we do. As we move ahead and we look ahead and specifically look at the issue of UNICEF and its role in fostering accountability under the human rights approach, why is this particularly important to focus on accountability? Firstly, is because there is so much unfinished business yet to realize. And as we move towards the SDG, that business becomes even more comprehensive. You know, we've had a universal mandate always, we now have a universal agenda. Secondly, because the question of accountability is critical to all of the sectors of our work. I happen to have given a number of examples that are more from, if you will, more acute violations of rights, but the work of national human rights institutions are equally applicable to education as it is to health, as it is to the wide variety of child rights issues that we're dealing with. So it's not just acute violations or indeed what I call sins of commission, but also often sins of omission, where there is a gap between what the state intends and what the country has promised and what it actually does. And then thirdly, because partnering with national human rights institutions can reinforce the work we do with those first lines of accountability that I mentioned, parents and communities, line ministries, ministries of finance, parliaments, and civil society organizations, as a kind of a check and balance, as a mechanism to keep us all honest and accountable. So I really look forward to this discussion on the panel and to the comments and questions, and over to the next speaker.
Thank you so much, Ted. That is very helpful in setting the tone and focusing on why UNICEF, why all of us need to be re-energizing our engagement with these institutions. But before going further to that, it would be good to ask Vanessa to help us clarify certain conceptual issues regarding these institutions, to remind us all, what are we talking about when we talk about national human rights institutions? Vanessa, thank you, and over to you.
Thank you very much. The presentation, I think, is loading, yes. Thank you very much, Susanna. Thank you, Ted, and Mitra and Nicola. I think to look at the role of NHRIs in SDG and child rights realization, we need to start from the specific nature of their monitoring role. It's not only passive monitoring, it's active monitoring. And that's what I call monitoring for change. And let's see now how they perform this. But first, let's look back at some terminology issue, just to be clear on what we're talking about. We have national human rights institutions, which are broad-based human rights institutions covering all of human rights, so human rights commissions and human rights defenders. We have what we call independent human rights institutions for children, which may be autonomous specialized bodies, such as Ombudsman for Children, Children's Advocates, or Children's Defenders, depending on the country context. But they may also be included, integrated into a national human rights institution, and in that case, they're like a child rights department, or we can have a deputy ombudsperson, a commissioner. But what's really critical is that it's an identifiable office, department, or body working on children's rights. Back to international standards. The two key sets of international standards are first the Paris Principles, which apply to all human rights institutions and have been adopted by the UN General Assembly in 1993. And the second one is General Comment Number 2 of the Committee on the Rights of the Child, which provides a child rights reading of the Paris Principle. And for anyone engaging in this type of work in the area of children's rights, this general comment is the key and the basis for everything. So where are those institutions? That was the situation in 1996. We see a few of them mainly in high-income countries. And at the end of 2012, when we finalized the research, we can see how much they have multiplied. And what's important here is that they're in all regions, and in countries with very various levels of development and legal tradition. So we cannot say anymore that it's a European concept. It has been adapted everywhere, and that's an important advocacy message. So how do they perform child rights monitoring? First of all, they build on an important framework, which is very specific. They're state institutions, so they're public, they're established by legislation, financed through the state budget, but at the same time, they're independent from all other state institutions. They're independent from the government, they're independent from the parliament, and therefore that enables them to have an external perspective and to monitor the work of all those institutions. As part of their framework, it's also important to underline that they need to have a CRC-based mandate or a mandate that mentions children's rights, because it's what's enabled them to have a child rights approach to their work. They use different tools for monitoring. One of them is research. They may carry out their own investigations, but they may also use information found by others or research done by others to compile and highlight some issues. That may be information from the parliament, the government, but also from NGOs and the academia, the media. And that's an important role in compiling, in gathering all of that information and making it available. The second aspect in child rights monitoring is monitoring visits to places where children are, detention centers, childcare institutions, but also when the mandate allows, private institutions, such as bars, where children may be at risk. A third very important mechanism is the complaint mechanism. It's this mechanism according to which when a child rights violation happens, the child or anyone who knows about the violation can file a complaint with the human rights institution. That's what we call a quasi-judicial mechanism, because it's a way, it's a mechanism for access to justice. It's in a way a justice mechanism, but it doesn't have all the formalities of the judiciary. There is no need for an attorney, it's free, there are no formalities attached to the way you file the lawsuit, etc. And therefore it's much more, it's meant to be much more accessible to children. In terms of approach, their child rights monitoring is also very specific. As Ted has underlined just now, it's not only about child protection, it's about the full range of rights, and it's about taking a multi-sectoral approach to the analysis of issues. The child is not only a pupil, a patient, it's the whole child. The holistic approach also applies to the various actors with which the institution works. State institutions, but also civil society and the media, and businesses, private companies and others. The child rights approach also implies direct contact with children through various participatory mechanisms, just to mention a few of them. Some have online presence, others have child advisory councils on a permanent basis within the institution, others visit remote villages or have various consultation campaigns. But what's important about the approach is it's also focused on the most marginalized, those who are most likely to have their rights violated or whose rights are already violated. So how do we translate monitoring into results? An important asset for these institutions is they rest on soft power. They rest on an influence, and that's how they act. They do not decide on legislation, but they advise on legislation. They cannot change themselves the system, but they can advise on how to change it. They can inform, they can set, put issues on the agenda. So that's why we call them the sort of the oil in the machine, the oil in the system that helps everyone work better. The question, of course, is that it's very difficult. The issue is that it's very difficult to attribute success to that particular institution because it's usually part of a broader movement. The human rights institution will also uncover some issues, meaning discovering them, but also speaking out about them when they're taboo and sensitive, and therefore putting them on the agenda. An important function is the link between the individual cases that they come to know through the complaint mechanism or through media attention, and the systemic issues that have led to those individual child rights violations to happen. So in other words, an individual violation is an expression of failures within the system that the institution is able to point out precisely due to this monitoring, holistic monitoring function. Independent institutions are independent from the state and independent from civil society, therefore in the middle. And that enables them to bring civil society's voice to decision makers. And that's a critical link between those two spheres that often do not communicate. And finally, independent human rights institutions for children have children's best interests at heart. They do not have a political agenda other than that of children. They're politically impartial, at least in principle, and therefore able to be voices on behalf of children. So that is a beautiful picture, but there are some limitations, and we need to emphasize them. These institutions are placed in a specific context, and that context also affects them. So if there are governance issues in the country, if the institutions are weak, it will be very difficult to have a very strong human rights institutions, or there needs to be some work in how to build on specific aspects. NHRIs, when they're integrated into broader human rights-based human rights institutions, the visibility of children's rights might be a challenge, like it is in every political system. Internally, child rights will compete with other issues, and it will be important to strengthen the child rights department. These institutions are meant to be accessible to children. However, we see from the research that access is still very difficult. Children are not aware of the existence of the institution. They don't know how to access it. And issues of access to public institutions are the same for these types of institutions. We know, for instance, that of all complaints filed even in the most advanced institution, less than 10% are filed directly by children. In terms of political leverage, it may be also a challenge because of their role focusing on influencing. The way that their recommendations are taken into consideration depends on their political clout, but it also defines itself their political clout. So you can have a virtuous or vicious circle, and that may affect their sustainability. If you're an institution and no one ever listens to you, it's a significant problem. There might be also sustainability issues, in relation to funding, in relation to independence, and that's something to be very mindful of. Threats are there and out there in the system, especially when sensitive issues are tackled. And those institutions also need to have their own accountability mechanism, because like any state institution, they also need to be accountable for their work, and usually that should be before the parliament. So how do we go from now going back to the SDG framework from child rights monitoring to SDG monitoring? And this is where I see their added value. First of all, we know that the SDGs are global, but they're implemented nationally. And so they're fully part of a process that is nationally owned, including for monitoring. It's not enough to have monitoring at the global level through reporting. There needs to be an institution inside the country looking at progress. We know that the SDGs have been formulated through intense participatory processes, and those participatory processes need to be kept in the context of monitoring progress, and these institutions are able to collect those voices on the ground. They are a critical link between this periodic reporting that will happen, the ongoing monitoring at the national level, and accountability for change. They are also a critical link between the SDG monitoring process and the treaty monitoring process, as well as the universal periodic review and ensuring that there is consistency among all these monitoring mechanisms. And finally, they are critical in ensuring the visibility of children's rights. We know many SDGs focus on children's rights, or some of them at least. Many are of critical relevance to children's rights, and all of them have some relevance in any case, and they're an important asset and ally to keep the visibility of children's rights on the agenda. So if you'd like to know more about this, so the Innocenti, the Office of Research Innocenti has issued a publication which includes a policy summary and a book. Feel free to translate the policy summary as needed. The book includes analytical chapters, regional analysis, but also very practical hands-on chapters. So with that, I thank you very much.
Vanessa, that was really helpful, and we feel like we are now in a more solid ground to go there to a very concrete example. Coming from Germany, we have Dominik Barr. And Dominik, can you hear us?
Yes, I can hear you.
Once again, let's try, because we don't hear you very well.
Is it better now? Hello?
You seem to be far from the mic. If you could come closer, that would be great.
Test again? Do you
yes,
hear better now?
Much better. Go ahead, please. I see that Julia is also with you, so welcome both.
Thank you.
Go ahead, Dominique, please.
Yes, thank you very much for the invitation to the UNICEF webinar. My name is Dominique Baer, and I am a policy advisor in the CRC monitoring body at the German Institute for Human Rights. With me is my colleague Julia Kerscher. She's also a policy advisor in the international department of the German Institute for Human Rights. And we would like now to present you the new CRC National Monitoring Body and the linkage with the SDGs here in Germany. So first I have to mention that the National Monitoring Body is a part of the Germany's independent national human rights institution, the German Institute for Human Rights here in Berlin. The German Institute for Human Rights fully complies with the Paris Principles, as Vanessa Zaletsky has mentioned, and has thus been bestowed with an A status. It's been assured in the summer of its own law for the German Institute. And the Institute for Human Rights contributes to protecting and promoting human rights in Germany. Now, the CRC monitoring body is a quite new institution. We started our work in this summer, and as Vanessa Zaletsky said, the CRC calls for national monitoring bodies in general comment number 2, that the committee said, the Committee on the Rights of the Child encouraged state parties to establish an independent institution for the promotion and monitoring of the implementation of the convention and support them in this regard by elaborating the essential elements of such institutions and activities which them. The CRC told Germany twice it is concerned regarding Germany. In the last concluding observation from February 2014, it is written that the committee remains concerned at the continued absence of a central body to monitor the implementation of the convention on federal, regional and community level, and which is also empowered to receive and address complaints to violation of children's rights. After this recommendation, the National Coalition of the NGOs in Germany strengthened the lobby work for the National Monitoring Body, and the federal government started working on this topic. On a press conference from the UNICEF National Committee in summer 2014, the State Secretary of the Youth Ministry in Germany declared the will to establish the National Monitoring Body in Germany. And then, 1 year later, in summer 2015, the Ministry of Youth granted the establishment of the CRC monitoring body for the next 2 years as an installation process. So now we just started our work, and our first task are the integration into the structure of the German Institute for Human Rights, right at the German NHRI. Our one main topic is the connection with the stakeholders, as there are the public authorities on federal, regional and community level. Then we have to hold consultations with NGOs working on issues of children and children themselves to let them participate in the monitoring process and tell us what are the main topics from their view. We have to work together with research institutes which do research on child topics, but not normally with the child rights approach. And then we have to contact with members of parliaments on all the levels of German politics, like federal, regional and community level. Our first research topic is the mapping on ombud mechanism for children. There we are looking the study Championing Child Rights from the UNICEF Center. There Germany is a white spot on the map. As you saw in the presentation of Vanessa Sedletsky, we now at National Monitoring Body don't have any complaint mandatory at the moment. So, but with the project, we are trying to start to show where there are ombud mechanisms, complaint mechanisms for children on the regional level in Germany to link them and get an overview on complaint mechanisms for children as foundation for systematic monitoring of legal protection for children's rights. So far, the establishment process of the CLC National Monitoring Body. Now, Vanessa will tell you how our work is linked. Julia will tell you how our work is linked to the SDG.
Yes, thanks, Dominic. Yes, as Dominic has said, we've just started thinking about this as the National Monitoring Body has just recently, last week, been established officially here in Germany. So we've started brainstorming on how we could link the National Monitoring Body's work to Germany's work overall on the SDGs. And as we know, Germany in the realm of the SDG is not only going to be a country supporting other countries in achieving the SDGs, but it will have to show how it's the country itself and its domestic policies as well implements and achieves the SDGs. So we're just going to share two brief ideas with you, and we would be very excited to hear from you and get more ideas and thoughts and suggestions from you on this. We found so far that the information flow, let's say, could work both ways. On the one hand, we feel that the work that the National Monitoring Body is going to do could really inform the German reports that Germany will submit to the global reviews on the SDGs. So Germany will be expected, like other countries, to review themselves on their progress towards SDGs. And Germany has actually said they want to be a very early country to report. So the mapping, just as an example, the mapping that Dominic has mentioned on complaints mechanism for children in Germany could actually really well inform the report of by Germany on its progress on Goal 16, which is sort of the governance goal, and which includes a target on access to justice, of course, also for children. So if we can show with, you know, the research that the monitoring body is now doing, how access to justice in this specific case, complaints mechanisms exist in Germany for children, that could be very useful information for the government's report on Goal 16 in its first report. And if the government wouldn't want to use that information, then civil society could always use that information in an alternative report, for example. So that would be one way how we could contribute to the review of the SDGs on Germany. The other way around, we feel that the SDG reviews on Germany could also be useful for the work of the institute, and specifically of the National Monitoring Body here in Germany. So that means it's not quite clear yet, as you all know, how the review mechanism at the global level will exactly be set up. But if we imagine a process where there will be recommendations for each country, which is possible, it would be very helpful for us to use recommendations that will be made on Germany and on the situation of children in Germany for our work here. So, for example, just to give you another example, if such recommendations on Germany around the SDGs were to say that there's a lack of information on the situation of children in a specific sector, for example, as we have assessed it ourselves here already, that would really help us here at the national level to push these debates, to advocate more, to engage, for example, with the National Statistical Office, or to engage with and collaborate with civil society to contribute their data, and so on. So that would be an example of how we could use the SDG reviews that will come from the global level at the national level. So we feel it could work both ways, but as we said, it's just very initial ideas, and we'd be very happy and grateful for any of your suggestions. Thank you.
Thank you so much to both of you, and this is also very illustrative of the ways we can link the monitoring of the SDGs with the work of the National Human Rights Institution. So a lot of ideas and food for thought. Finally, we will go to Regina, our rep in Morocco, to show briefly as well her perspective from that country. And then we will wrap up and open wrap up with the panelists to open a space for comments and questions. Over to you, Regina.
Thank you very much, colleague, for this opportunity. In Morocco, the Human Rights Independent Monitoring Institution is the Conseil National des Droits de l'Homme, so the National Council for Human Rights. It has been established by the Constitution in 2011, and UNICEF started since then to engage with them, mainly in knowledge generation and in advocacy. Recently, we started to build a more strategic partnership with them, and we are supporting their work in training not only their unit in child rights monitoring, but also civil society, media, and private sector, which is helping them in building a sensitive corporate social responsibility towards children rights. Law is being about to be adopted actually at the parliament, we hope very soon, which will establish a formal complaint mechanism in individual cases, of course targeting children, women, and persons with disability, in line with the Paris Declaration principle that Vanessa has explained a little bit before. It's a fully independent mechanism which will also give the possibility to children to access directly for complaints. So to get prepared on this work, UNICEF has been working with them to strengthen their monitoring function, but especially to shape a curricula on children rights, which will help strengthening the capacity of their staff to carry out this job. And mainly we tackle the issue of governance, so we tackle the issue of access from children and vulnerable community to the mechanism that the SDGs is putting in place. We try to strengthen their decentralization, so they have established 13 commissions in all Moroccan territory, and we are working with them and with the civil society, which is very active at the local government level. A new dimension that we are adding is their engagement with media as one of their important partners to monitor the situation in the field, but also to disseminate the importance of children's rights amongst the community. So we work to create a space where the evidence is generated from the local level, and also access is being provided if there are violations. And then the centralized body at Rabat level could act and try to create a political response and influence the political response. The curricula is rather interesting because it doesn't touch only the legal instruments available, but it also go into technique for interviewing, technique for assuring child participation. So we are very excited about the initiative. We were also able to leverage the interests of the European Union in this work, and some EU member states, some bilateral, notably Netherlands and France, and we hope to bring other UN agencies around the table, because the complaining mechanism is not only dealing with children, but also with women and persons with disabilities. What is also important to know is that the center aims at becoming a regional center for creating capacity of independent monitoring mechanism, not only in Maghreb, but mainly in the MENA region, and perhaps with the ambition of having some partners from Western Africa. So the independent monitoring institution already started to finalize some memorandum of understanding and protocol of exchanges with other similar institutions in the region. As Vanessa rightly said, this institution may have different forms. There may be an independent human rights mechanism. There may be specialized on this person. In some countries, unfortunately, we have none of them, but we have the civil society who is performing independent monitoring. That's why an important part of the curricula of the training center will also target civil society capacity in performing independent monitoring. For us, it's the beginning of the work, but we think that from the governance part and the architecture part, we are starting well. We will need as much as possible expertise, even from European countries. So we were glad to hear about the experience that is being performed in Germany, and try to create more linkages between the European Union and this part of the world as well. For us, it's very clear that there is a linkages between the SDGs and the unfinished agenda that the countries need to deliver to increase accountability. But there is also an opportunity to maximize South-South that goes behind government, a South-South that try to increase a national capacity of also civil society and independent monitoring institution. That's the only type of engagement that will guarantee us that the data, the evidence, the violation are reported and also addressed. Perhaps another element very important is the political leverage that this institution nowadays has in Morocco vis-a-vis not only the government but also the parliament. And I think it has been said before, the credibility of this institution and their independence is fundamental to be able to deliver. So from our experience from a country office, I think this was the most important exercise. Mapping if really the organization is independent, mapping if there is an independence in terms of budget and reporting, and if they are really free of political influence to be able then to invest in a longer term.
Thank you, Regina. This is a very concrete description of how we engage with these institutions at country office level, and we will have the opportunity to perhaps go back to detail a bit more. But now I would like to just thank you all the panelists and quickly open the door, the floor. For comments, questions, I would invite colleagues to just open your mics and formulate your questions or comments as briefly as possible so that we make the most out of the rest of the time. You are also welcome to just type your questions or comments, and we will be delivering that to the panelists. So please go ahead and let us know. Introduce yourself, please, and let us know if you have a comment. In the meantime, perhaps we can take this opportunity to ask Vanessa regarding the mapping of the human rights institutions for children, as presented in the global study. We see that the stand of that mapping is 2012, and we were wondering whether there has been some update on that mapping, as well as how the mapping actually collected the information we see in the global description of those institutions, that, for instance, Brazil is not indicated as having some child rights, human independent institutions. Some other countries, such as Sri Lanka, are also not there. So if you could comment on what was what were the criteria for the mapping. Quickly, Vanessa, please.
Yeah, thank you. The criteria for the mapping were based on the CRC Committee General Comment number 2 provision that says that each and that an institution can be called an independent human rights institution for children when it's clearly identifiable. So the criteria we took was, one, whether there was an independent institution at the national level specializing in children's rights, so like an ombudsperson, for instance, or if there was an NHRI, was there within that institution a clearly defined office? We're not talking about a series of persons who do a bit of children's rights as part of their daily work. For instance, the person sitting in the communications dealing a bit with children's rights, or the person sitting in the complaint mechanism office, sometimes seeing child rights reports on child rights violations. What we're talking about is a real team, or at least one person, completely dedicated to children's rights, and that can be identified also from the outside as the sort of the child rights spokesperson. So with that in mind, we went through CRC committee reporting documents, state reports, but also concluding observations. We contacted a number of country offices when there was a doubt. We looked at legislations, institutions, websites. We also carried out a survey in all of Latin America and all of Europe. So for Brazil, for instance, we had a long debate, but it came to our attention that there was not at the time such an identifiable institution at the national level. In Sri Lanka, the situation is a bit different because there is a National Commission on Child Protection, but it's a government coordinating body. At least at the time it was, it might have changed lately. But it's part of the government and it's meant to coordinate government action in child protection. And that often exists in many, in very many countries that have such bodies. And when advocating for independent monitoring mechanism, we really try to differentiate between the two, even if there are some common roles and common functions. They usually don't have the independent status that's needed. Now, things change a lot, and I fully agree that it would need to be updated. I try to keep track sometimes of development, but it needs to be very systematic. And it has been an extremely intense and careful exercise to produce those maps because we knew it would get a lot of attention.
Okay, thank you, Vanessa. We have many questions now. We can go ahead with some of them. But before that, also Ted has a question for Vanessa, or?
No, generally. No, I mean, Vanessa, we could certainly take that discussion forward in terms of what is independent or not, and indeed what the status is. And I'd welcome taking that offline. But what I would like to hear, and I see some of this coming in on comments, is indeed what would be useful from within UNICEF in order to advance this work, like what would help. And I already see some ideas coming down. It'd be useful to have an opportunity to discuss how we can take this forward as an agenda, I think, in order to support NHRIs more broadly and you know, as an instrument of child rights in a variety of contexts.
And I think that that is very much aligned to many of the questions that we are receiving. Very concretely, if we could start, you know, indicating exactly the ways we can strengthen our work with them.
Yeah, thank you. I can't, there is too many comments for me to read all of them. But generally speaking, I believe it is part of UNICEF's agenda in promoting the implementation of the CRC. It's one of the general measures of implementation of the CRC, like legislation in line with the CRC, like budgets, like access to justice and so on. So it's really within that context, and it's a broad policy context, even though it's oftentimes within child protection, it's quite a horizontal issue. the way UNICEF can be engaged is by promoting such independent monitoring bodies. And it's very difficult to give a strict line on how to do this because it so much depends on the country context. In many instances, if there is already a national human rights institution and it's functioning, it may make sense to promote the idea, like in Morocco, of having a specialized child rights mechanism within that national human rights institution. In other instances where there is no national human rights institution, it's weak, or there are some political issues associated with it, it might make sense to promote a specialized body. But that being said, and I think, I mean, again, the basis for UNICEF engagement is really that independent child rights monitoring is an obligation for any state that has ratified the CRC. But the one thing to be careful of is when UNICEF engages in such work, there really needs to be buy-in at the national level, because it would be very easy for UNICEF to say, we will fund, support a person or a group of persons, provide funding to an institution to work on children's rights. But that wouldn't necessarily provide the independence from UNICEF and the perception that it's a UNICEF, two UNICEF-sponsored body to enable for national ownership. And that's one of the issues that we've seen in some countries when the child rights mechanism is heavily donor-based. Now, an important strategy for UNICEF at the national level is to identify the supporters, to map out the mechanisms that already exist, identify the supporters, and identify the added value it would bring to existing mechanisms. And that's really the way to advocate at the national level for such institutions, to show what they would bring to each, to the media, what they would bring to you, to NGOs, what they would bring to you, to the social worker working in a childcare institution, how would it help you do your job, and to the government, to the parliaments, and to the parliamentary groups that work on children's issues. I think this is really critical.
Thank you, Vanessa. I would ask Mitra, my colleague here, to read out loud some of the questions that are coming in, and we'll try to address them.
All right, so we see that there are some questions about how we can engage with national human rights institutions or child rights institutions on child rights. Now the SDGs indicators are still being discussed and will only be finalized in the first part of next year. I think the key answer to that is that, well, we already know the goals, and in any case, the basis of the work is obviously the CRC. So that's the main ground on which we can, base all form of collaboration. So in that sense, linking up the CRC with the goals, which are already known, and the targets, is already a first step. And of course, more fine tuning can be done later on once the indicators will be available. But we should, by all means, not wait for the indicators to be developed to start the partnership. There was also one question about the contacts within PD. So this webinar series is organized by the Human Rights Unit under Susanna. So the Human Rights Unit is composed by Nicolas Brandt, whom most of you already know, Nicolette Moody, who's based in Geneva, and myself, Mitra Motlag, also in New York. So by all means, feel free to reach out to us, and we'll be very happy to help you out in developing or strengthening activities you might want to initiate with national human rights institutions. Also, I saw a couple of questions that maybe Dominique could very briefly touch base on. It was one related to the independence of the institution, especially when looking at the funding. So if you could just briefly explain how you managed to remain independent while your funding is actually coming from the government. And also the second question also that was relevant is, how can NATCOMs also be of support? And I believe that the rights institution in Germany has a very strong relationship with the UNICEF NATCOM. So if Dominique could take a minute to just briefly answer the couple of questions, that would be great.
Yeah, we also had a long discussion about independence and funding here with our new national monitoring body and also with the German Institute for Human Rights. And so in this summer, we just had a change for the whole institute in the funding, because before it was funded by some ministries to special topics. And since summer, we have an own law on the institute and, 2016. Going from the German parliament, from the ministry. So we are now more independent from the government and more linked to parliament. But maybe Julia can say more about.
Yeah, and just one other way of ensuring our independence is that our board includes representatives from different ministries, but when it comes to decisions about the direction and the content of the institute, those government representatives are not allowed to vote, basically. So we disconnect the funding from part of the decision making, basically. Mitra, if you like to address one or two or three other questions, would that be helpful?
Wait a minute, Dominic. We see also a question regarding from Marta, PFP, asking whether there is some thinking about this linkage between SDG and CRC monitoring. On that regard, as many of you may know, UNICEF usually has a biannual meeting with the CRC committee. The next one is going to take place in January. Actually, Ted is going to lead the delegation from UNICEF, and as usual, we will enter into dialogue on how to strengthen our work with the CRC committee. This time around, on the agenda, a central focus for the agenda is how to come closer in terms of CRC monitoring and SDG. There are some ideas from our side and also from their side, and we hope that in that particular occasion we will be able to hone in how exactly we can move forward. And of course, the ultimate goal of this is to translate whatever takeouts of that meeting to concrete program guidance, and we will of course let you know, NATCOMs and country offices as well.
Mitra, would you like me to address two more questions?
If you can do it very briefly, that'd be great.
Yeah, I think they were just clarification questions. There was one question from Lale asking about youth-driven platforms to monitor the SDGs. And there will be, of course, a lot of work around that. But just to say that in the process of the negotiation of the development, the drafting of the SDGs, stakeholders in New York were organized in so-called major groups. And there is a major group on youth that was very vocal and very active during the negotiations. And I would assume another one that was very vocal and active was the women's major group, for example. And it's quite likely that these groups will continue to advocate and probably also play a role, a self-selected role in the monitoring of the SDGs. So be in the room basically when the reviews take place at the global level. So that was that question. Maybe it helps, the major groups might play a role, the youth major group at the global level. And then there was a question about the difference over the mechanism of national mechanisms to monitor the SDGs. And on that one, just to say, as far as I know from the discussions now, there will be both. There will be a global monitoring mechanism where countries present their reviews, their reports in New York. But there will also be even a regional review level, and every country is supposed to conduct national reviews at the national level as well, which are meant to be participatory and inclusive. So just very briefly on those two questions, maybe.
Thank you so much, Dominique. Colleagues, we have pretty much covered the questions, but Ted will help us wrap up this panel and very interesting discussions, and also let us know a few steps ahead of us as a result of this discussion.
Thank you.
First of all, colleagues, thanks for, I think, a very useful discussion, and again, a good set of comments through the comment input that we got, which have helped us think through how we take this forward. A few ideas. Firstly, we will collect the different comments that were sent in and send to all participants a document with some brief suggested answers and next steps when there's a specific action being recommended. Second, as Susanna has already indicated, we are planning to meet with the CRC committee in January, and that will be an opportunity to speak overall about how we engage on with national human rights institutions and the links between CRC monitoring and SDG monitoring. Third, there's a number of questions about lessons learned, best practices, and indicators. And what we propose to do is have an overall guidance on engaging with national human rights institutions and build on the work that was already done that was presented here today to capture both some of the best practices, some suggested indicators, and some practical way that we can exchange experiences so that not just experiences from Germany and Norway can be shared with places around the world, but also experiences from places around the world such as Morocco and some of the other places that were mentioned here today can also be shared with Germany and Norway, and indeed that we also look at the opportunity for greater South-South cooperation in this regard. And then finally, to indicate that UNICEF's been part of a group that's been looking at ways to support the localization and domestication of the SDGs at country level under something called MAPS, which is Mainstream Acceleration and Policy Support. So it's going to be the UN approach to supporting the implementation and follow-up of SDGs at country level. And in this regard, one of the steps we can take is incorporate engagement with and interest in national human rights institutions for children in the process of MAPS at country level. With that, thank you very much, colleagues, and I turn it back to Susanna.
Thank you, Ted, and very useful to have very clearly spelled out our actions as we move forward. And thank you all, colleagues. We reach a very encouraging number of participants, 53 participants have been connected to this discussion. Thank you, all the panelists. You have provided an excellent and diverse overview on this issue and how we can work with these institutions. And let me, before I really finalize, invite you to the next edition of this webinar series on December 11th. We will be focusing on connected but different type of accountability mechanism. This type would be social accountability. And as you know, this is increasingly important also in the context of the SDGs. We will have, among other panelists, our director of PPD division here in New York, dealing with engagement throughout the SDG process. So we are very hopeful that you will be engaging with us as well. And thank you all for the interest, and hope you have a great day wherever you are sitting. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.